right, this is Absolute Radio at Hard Rock Calling, and we have just heard one of the most incredible performances I have heard in a very long time, and the voice came from this girl, Rox. Good to see you.
Hello, how you doing?
I'm fine, all the better for seeing and meeting you. That is an incredible voice you have.
Thank you. No, we had a lot of fun. I mean, I didn't even know it was going to be like a proper performance thing on a stage. I thought it was like going to be like a little tent, me and you, like shacked up somewhere and the band in the corner, but it was very different. There was like people sitting down eating food with chandeliers.
We can do the shacking up later, but when did you realise you had this incredible voice, this great talent?
It's hard for me to say exactly when it was, but I think probably it was when I started to go to church, really. I went from the age of like 5 with my grandparents because my granddad was a pastor. And I remember this very persistent choir master there called Ruben. And from the age of 7, he started to get me like by the piano and go through scales with me. He'd teach me songs, and I was thinking, why the hell is this dude doing this to me? I just want to go and play with my friends. Yeah. I want to have lunch. But you know, he must have saw some potential, and the more I learned and the more he forced me to perform at the front of the choir, the more I enjoyed it, and the confidence grew, the voice grew, and it sort of led me to where I am today. So
the BBC, I think, put you in one of these polls that they do at the end of every year when they sort of tip people for big things and huge success in the following 12 months, which is great. And I'm sure you love the hype, but then does that pile on the pressure?
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of like a catch 22, isn't it? It's like it's a weird thing. It's great for people to recognise what you do and say you're good for what you do, but it also means that they're watching that much more, you know, closer. And I don't know, I just try not to concentrate on it so much. I just do what I do. I perform, I interact with fans and just try and grow a fan base that way. Because I don't know, I think the media can be very fickle. They're very easy to hype you up and equally as easy to sort of tear you down. So
she's jaded already, and
I'm just realistic, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, there is that.
I'm all about like the live circuit and for people to connect with my music organically. So,
and talking of the live circuit, you seem to be doing a lot of festivals this summer.
Yeah.
I mean, is that good fun, or is it a bit of a pain in the neck, you know, living out of a suitcase? Or I suppose it's what you wanted to do.
Yeah, I mean, it can be a pain living out of a suitcase, but it's so worthwhile once you get on that stage and you know you're performing to a group of people mostly that have never heard of you before, and once you win them over, that's just like
the beauty about
ever.
You is you win them over within about 2 seconds the moment you opened your mouth.
Not
it was
always.
Like we were like, all right, this girl's good.
Not always but I had a festival yesterday in Brussels, the Couleur Cafe, and that was amazing, you know, because I didn't really know what to expect coming out of my hometown, coming out of my country, and they were singing along to my songs.
Wow.
I was like, what the hell is actually happening right now? Is this real? And it was, but it was great.
And one of the people you've really won over is our friend, Mr. Paul Weller.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about how you got in touch with him, or and how you ended up doing a duet with him.
Well, the weird thing is that he got in touch with me.
Wow.
Which I can't really understand. I got like a phone call from my management saying Paul Weller wants you to do a duet with him.
Yeah,
and
whatever.
My first reaction was like, has he got the right person? I was really sure what happened. So I went to a rehearsal, I met him, I was so bloody scared. And the first thing he said to me was like, oh, you alright, Rox? And I was like, yeah, you alright. So scared. He's like, do you want a cup of tea, love? And he made me a cup of tea. And it was just like, this is a normal bloke. This is a normal, talented bloke that is so unfazed by all the crap. And we got on so well. And that was for like a little Radio 2 session. And then he asked me back to perform with him at the Royal Albert Hall. And that was like next level craziness. And he has such devoted fans as well. And they were so welcoming. And yeah, it was great. Something I always remember.
Well, I mean, he loves you. That's the first time I've seen you play live, and I am a fan like that. You said to me earlier on, are you going to come and watch me at 4:15? We're all coming at 4:15 to watch you. Where can the people who are listening to the interview or watching it, when can they see you, and what's the deal with some stuff which we can, you know, get?
Just released my debut album, Memoirs. It was released 2 weeks ago, so you can get it on iTunes, HMV, those sort of things. And next gig in England, I can't even say London because I can't remember, but I think, no, London, Lovebox.
Lovebox.
Come to Lovebox,
are you doing
people.
Am I right in saying you're doing, are you doing V Festival as well?
Yes, V Festival, Latitude Festival, Underage Festival.
At a festival near you soon.
Yes. So what? If you're by, come down and we'll have some wine together.
Yeah, we noticed you've got the biggest. I mean, I thought there was a goldfish in there. Look at the size of that bottle of a glass of wine. Lovely to meet you.
I'm not an alcoholic, I promise.
Enjoy the rest of your weekend and have a great performance later. We'll be there.
Thank you very much.
Lovely to meet you.
Thank you.